So, I heard Casey Neistat talk about how the body just serves to support our head and our brain in his video, A Guide to Life. Let's talk about that. Think about this a lot, and the reason why is because I had a lot of challenges in my life that had to do with understanding people. So I went on a journey to understand people better. And in doing so, I learned a lot about behavior of people and why we behave the way we do behave. And I learned to use that also to help other people. And what did I find out? What is that that is so important that I want to share with you? The thing is this, that we are still stuck on some level of thinking in a very old way, like going all the way back to Descartes and how he said, like, I think, therefore I am. So, discarding emotions, just I am thinking, I'm using my rational brain, rationality, and therefore I am. And then we have, like, way later, we have Freud talking about your consciousness and how it puts your subconscious under control because your subconscious is bad and it just wants all those rotten things. It just wants to have sex all the time. That's all you can think about, isn't it? Admit it now. So yeah, that's what comes from that split about body and mind. But we have come a long way from that. Technology has improved. We have gone from philosophy, our philosophy thinking about who we are, and we moved to psychology, and there is still a lot of philosophy in psychology, but that's not a good thing. So we started with guessing about how we are and how our brain works, and the more technology we got, the more easier and the more detailed we could see what really is going on. So we went from using X-rays to see inside the body, so for some vision of the body inside, to having PET scans, to using MRI, fMRI, what is seeing how the blood flows in your brain. So thinking like where the most blood flows in your brain, there is the most activity. Where the more oxygen it has, the more blood there is, so the more activity there is. So, but it's still somewhat of guesswork, even with using fMRI. And then we go to AAG, what's using measuring electronic, electrical, sorry, electrical currents between the neurons, so electrical charges between the neurons, but it's not still that accurate, and it was way better than before. We could see way more than before, and in that way we learned a great deal about how our brain operates. And then we have SNI, what is single neuro imaging, so you could really zoom in on a single neuron. see how that neuron operates. So we have come a long way, but still we're holding on to those old things because most of us aren't that educated in understanding how far we have come and what we have learned in neurology. And thinking about that guesswork, let's ask ourselves some questions about that. So, I have some questions for you, and here are some. How can you recognize a loved one without emotions? How could you know you love somebody, recognize, ah, that's somebody I love, if you don't have emotions attached to that memory of that person? How can you make a rational decision, decide if you like something or not, if you want to do something or not, if you don't have an emotional response to something? How can you make a decision when you have no emotions like gratification from something or disgust from something? Think about it, and then you see that how emotions and decisions and memory all are connected. You can't have rationality without emotions. That comes from the work of a neuroscientist called Antonio Damasio, and he wrote a book that I love called Descartes' Error. And he has another book what I really love is The Feeling What Happens, The Feeling of What Happens, and I will put the links below. And then you have writers who try to study scientific subjects and make it more easier for the public to understand. And that's something wonderful, because now more people begin to be interested in parts of science, in neurology, because it is made, it is simplified. That's something positive and negative being simplified. So it's a double edged sword, yeah. What writer I really love in that writes about neurology is Malcolm Gladwell, and I'm sure you've heard about this guy before, or you know somebody else who have read a book about it. Maybe you've heard the title about from one of his books, but don't know the name, Malcolm Gladwell. But one of the interesting things is that he has written a book called Blink. It's a wonderful book. I can recommend it seriously. I didn't read the book, to be honest. I listened to the audiobook. So, yeah, you can also listen to an audiobook if you don't like to read. And sometimes I read and sometimes I listen. And there are interesting stories in that book, Blink. One, for instance, about pilots, I think of F9, F-19, something like that. And the jet pilot needs to react to a rocket being launched at him. But that rocket is, of course, very fast, so he hasn't have time to think. He has to react before he thinks. So he has to have a strong and very fast reaction. He has to make a decision before he knows he can rationalize it. You understand? And there's another story about control tower was overseeing a mission, and there was he saw on his screen like just dots. That's what they see in the control tower, just dots. And there were was one dot he recognized as a pilot from them. So and there was two dots appearing fast behind that one dot. So what do you do? What is it? You're the control tower. You can also send missiles. And that person decided to press that button to send the missiles to the two dots on the on his map. But how did he know that it wasn't like friendly planes? How did he know that it were rockets, that it were missiles that were after that pilot? And so, how did he know? Well, to be honest, he had to also decide really fast. And what he did was have intuition about it. Strong intuition what it was, and he reacted fast. And when he needed to go and explain what he was doing, because people were worried about why he made that decision, and he had to explain himself. Then he just said that he had that intuition. And so you see that you can have a great intuition about something before you have a rational understanding about it. And in doing so, in having that great intuition, you have to got a strong sense of the field you're in. You have to got expertise. You have to got a whole lot of experience built up over time before you can make such a accurate, intuitive decision that is correct. So you just can't like try to guess all the time and think like it will be 90% correct of the time. You have to first have experience, 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 and then you can have that great intuition. And the same counts for art. There are people who know a great lot of about art, and what they do when they see if it's a fake or not, sometimes they can't explain it, but they feel like if it's a genuine artwork or not. And so again, rationality comes in later, maybe even in hindsight. So what can we learn from this? What can we take away from this for ourselves and use it in our daily life to use it when we want? And how can we take this and apply it in our lives? What can we take away? And the thing that we can take away is that our whole body processes information and takes decisions for us, even before we know it. We have to be in tune of that. Have to be attuned to those intuitions to feel them. And we have to have a whole lot of experience build up over time to have an accurate intuition. And when we understand that our whole body holds neurology, and not only your brain, that the whole of neurology is in whole body, then we begin to understand how things are. And one of those people who really understand it was George Lakoff. George Lakoff is a neurolinguist. So he studies how our neurology is reflected in how we talk, in our language that we use, also in how we think. And how we think is in metaphors. We use metaphors to think. That are the connections we make. Those are metaphors. Everything we can communicate are metaphors. In understanding that, there are certain parts of the brain. When you understand how they work together, you begin to see why it is important. So let's start with the first part. And the first part I want to talk about is the brainstem. The brainstem who controls like heartbeat and your breathing. And it goes to your central nervous system. That is in your spine. And it goes to your intestines and your bowels. So you can have a gut feeling. Your limbic system, who processes your appetite, your emotions, your memory, and some hormone regulations. And then you have the thalamus, which is like a center that regulates between other brain parts, but also between like the lower brain parts and your neocortex, like the newer part of your brain. That is the next part I want to talk about. Your neocortex is good in planning, language, social understanding, like understanding social situations and where you are in that situation and what's appropriate in that situation and what's not appropriate in a social situation. It has a map of your whole body and it has a map that translates actions, a map of actions so you can move elegantly. So it connects like a lot of single actions in one single beautiful move. So we don't think about like taking a glass, like moving our arm. Let's move this part now. Let's come closer. Let's see if our fingers can move. Yeah, I can take this. Okay. But it goes like in one move, up and to our mount. So it lacks a lot of coordination there. And why do I want to tell you this? The reason is this. Because those things are so connected. When you've heard like appetite and emotions, those are connected. When you like emotions and memory, those are connected. And you will see that in metaphors. So let's go over some metaphors, shall we?
Yeah.
Let's go to some metaphors. I've put down here some. And maybe you are hungry for some knowledge. You see, hungry, stomach, digestion, and memory. Maybe you want to fill your memory with something. Just like you fill your stomach with something. And maybe you find a certain person disgusting. Or maybe you find a certain part of behavior disgusting. So you're using olfactory senses to talk about people and behavior. You see how emotions and our olfactory systems work together in the limbic system also. and maybe people are looking down on you. But maybe you want to get something off your chest. Chin up. Maybe you got a nose for mystery. And even if you're up to your elbows, you have to keep them at arm's length. You begin to see how we use our body as a first map to map everything that we understand to that. And then we use that map, we extend it to other things, to relate to other things. But the first language we have is the language of the body. Because it's one system. And so you see how to use it, and maybe you can use it in your daily life. You can dip a toe in and put your best foot forward. And let's go even deeper than that. Corporations, you know, like Google or something, or what's another big corporation? Maybe Tesla, because I like Tesla. And Facebook, other big corporations. Corporations, we see them as people. They are entities. And we think about corporations in a way as we think about people. How do they treat us? How do they treat others? How trustworthy are they? You see how we use metaphors of ourselves, of our body, and put them on things outside of us. Because the only way we start to use language is to use the metaphors that we have about our body and extend them outside of things outside of us. Of us. Outside of us. I'm outside of myself, you see? And this understanding is called embodied cognition, and it comes from George Lakoff. I will put links of George Lakoff down in the description also for you. And so, in conclusion, what can we say about the body and the brain? That it is codependent, that the brain can only make sense of things due to the body. It has to first learn and regulate bodily functions and understand those. And then it uses bodily language to other things also. And with this understanding, you can improve your communication even. So you see, it's not versus, not one thing that is more or less important than other is one system. Enjoy it. Have a nice day. Bye.